and poverty, we bring you Africa, a country of lions, grazing gazelle, and Trevor Noah. Ebola all-stars, malaria, well-meaning dictators, and Nelson Mandela, played by Idris Elba. Home of blockbuster movies based on a true story, like The Lion King. Africa, 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 Africa. Not to be confused with South Africa. No, this is Africa. From the heart of Africa, we bring you Zambezi News.
Good evening and welcome to Zambezi News. My name is Jerome Weathers.
And I am Mandape Mandape.
We are the Zambezi News team from Zimbabwe, which, as you all know, is just to the right of Bolivia. Just north of Brazil. No, I'm joking. Zimbabwe actually used to be part of Australia until an earthquake in June 1987. And since then, it's been a floating island close to Hawaii.
Zimbabwe is actually a sovereign nation in Southern Africa, and it's well renowned for breaking many world records. We have record-breaking inflation standing at 200 million%. We also have one of Africa's longest-lasting leaders. Mugabe just keeps going and going like an African energizer bunny. We also have the world's most predictable election results. The ruling party, ZANU-PF, always wins.
Well, we cross now to our first report with our field reporter, Kephis Josvats, who's reporting from the recently successfully held elections in Bulilamangwe. Over to you, Kephis.
They say when elephants fight, only the grass suffers. And some would have us believe that the grass is greener on the other side. However, camels do not like their backs being broken by the final straw. Such is the case here in upper northeast Bulilamangwe in rural Cholocho near the Tropic of Capricorn, 95 degrees in the shade. We are here at the local polling station where 50,000 votes have been cast even before the aforementioned station is even opened. This goes to show the eagerness and unrivaled dexterity of the three local villagers to exercise their democratic rights. We caught up with one or two of the local villagers.
Actually, I'm coming from the grinding mill. I was just grinding my maize, but they didn't let me vote.
There you have it. You have heard it for yourself from the horse's mouth. They have voted in their thousands. They have put their X next to sovereignty. Kephis Josvats, in a difficult to name place with too many L's.
As you can see, we are masters of running transparent elections. We ensure that only the patriotic are allowed to vote so that the patriotic are allowed to win. We disallow those with Western and opposition tendencies, such as those that are young and those that live in urban areas, and of course those that didn't die in our liberation struggle. Because after all, we died for our country.
Mandape, I wouldn't say that we have peaceful elections because we're always blaming someone. We blame the West, we blame the opposition.
But that's just how it is come election time. In Zimbabwe, we blame the imperialists and the foreign-funded opposition. In Europe, they blame the refugees and illegal immigrants. In America, Trump blames the dirty Mexicans. It's just how it is come election time. Join us after this.
Somewhere in the heart of the Midwest.
I've got to save Africa.
You're so selfless, honey.
a dream must be fulfilled, a risk taken. Famine Pictures presents a heartwarming tale of bravery and sacrifice. He killed thousands, single-handedly. He saved the entire continent, and they didn't even know from what. In fact, they hadn't even asked for his help. The entire cast died around him. But he survived. One man, alone, in Africa. One man, one quest, thousands of powerless extras, and 11 years in the making. White Knight rising in a dark continent. Coming soon to a theater near you.
Some of Jerome's reckless kith and kin there.
Mandapi, I'll have you know that my ancestors are more the outdoorsy explorer types. You know, we discovered things like the Great Zimbabwe ruins, the Victoria Falls, and even the wonderful pyramids of Egypt, which actually weren't that easy to find.
And I'm sure you whites made lots of friends along the way.
Well, we mainly helped the locals naming their ancient relics so the hapless chaps wouldn't forget what they were. Our philanthropy knew no bounds. We built schools, railroads, and hospitals. Granted, they were for whites only, but it's the thought that counts.
Join us after this short commercial break.
Today, gays are everywhere. This is the story of how gays colonized Africa. The birthplace of the gays, Westminster, 1765. Queen Jeremy leads the gays aboard the Rainbow Warrior. A few lesser-known lesbians join the crew. Daunted by the enormous task ahead of them, Queen Jeremy leads the crew in an ABBA medley to lift their spirits. The groping of Africa has begun. First stop, Tunisia, where native chiefs sell off their ripe teenage sons to Queen Jeremy in return for colored beads and 3 yards of mutton cloth. Rounding the buttocks of Africa, the gays erect a fabulous camp from where they launch their attack on African culture, morality, family life, diet, and interior design. Having sucked the marrow from the bone of Africa, Louis Leakey, an undercover gay agent, and his transsexual lover, Mary George, penetrate the dark interior. They emerge from the Rift Valley with ancient gay fossils and some new friends, whom they name after famous Roman gays. Homo habilis, Homo sapiens, Homo erectus. It doesn't get gayer than that. Failing to get a grip on the Horn of Africa, and overwhelmed by large Ugandans, the gays turn and flee south, pursued from behind. They flee to Cape Town, where they settle in Camp Bay. They rewrite the constitution and introduce musical theater to the natives. The Rainbow Nation is born.
Definitely from your tribe, Jerome. All evidence points west on that one, eh?
Excuse my homophobic colleague, his upbringing was a blinkered one. Well, now we go into the main segment of our program, the interview section, where we're going to be interviewing two of the world's leading minds. Forget about this guy who's trying to manipulate gravity or that first Western student to North Korea. These guys make headlines on a daily basis.
They are the stuff of legends, trailblazers in political science, and the women have dubbed one of them a gentleman lover.
Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you the award-winning, mesmerizing, and yet always humble duo of Jerome Weathers and Mandapi Mandapi. Yes, that's right, us.
So, tell me, what's it like running a satirical show in Zimbabwe?
Well, we're Zimbabwe's leading satirical news show. We're also Zimbabwe's only satirical news show. People tend not to do satirical news show in Zimbabwe. I'm not sure if it's because we're living in a dictatorship or something, but our show is it's a parody of the state-controlled Zimbabwe Broadcasting Corporation, which oozes out relentless propaganda. I mean, their reporting has got endless bungling. So they provide 50% of our content. The Zimbabwe Broadcasting Corporation are our biggest inspiration. The funny thing, though, is that we're a TV show that's not allowed on TV. So we have to find creative means of distributing our content via DVD, via WhatsApp, and via social media. Now, Madape, a question for you. What's it like being a broadcaster in the oppressive Zimbabwean context?
Well, we report the news patriotically. But unfortunately, the government doesn't always see it that way. I mean, sure, some of our lead actors get harassed and intimidated by state agents, but these agents are also doing their patriotic duty of intimidating and abducting, as well as general skullduggery. But enough of the easy stuff. Time for the tough questions. In a fight between a vegetarian polar bear and an 800-pound cockroach in the Sahara Desert, who would take that fight?
Is it in an oil field and are American troops involved?
Yes, they always are.
Can I call a friend?
No.
The squirrel, then.
Riveting stuff.
Now a question for you, Mandape, a serious question. Which three African dictators would you marry, screw, and kill? And why?
Not that I swing that way, but I'd marry our president, Mugabe, because he has staying power, and that's guaranteed to be a long-lasting relationship there. Screw, that would go to President Sisi of Egypt, because he's well-skilled in screwing over the Egyptian people. Kill Donald Trump, that's a no-brainer, much like his campaign. But back to this Zambezi news business. Why do you do it?
Well, I think satire is a great way of reaching young people, and that's our target demographic. So our message manages to reach millions of young Zimbabweans, and at the same time, there's nothing more challenging than doing a cheeky news show in a not-so-free country. I mean, I think our viewership levels are so high because the majority of our viewers are state security agents who are doing surveillance on us. Now, a question for you, Mandape. What impact do you really think this satire thing is having?
None. But for the sake of the intellectuals in the room, when we started this satirical show, there were no satirical productions in Zimbabwe. But now there's a wonderful array of satirical productions and political comedy that's also speaking truth to power. I mean, sure, they don't have my ravishingly good looks, but they're young. They will learn. It's also a great time to be doing satire on the continent, as you have political satire in Kenya, Senegal, and South Africa. Feels like we're part of one big sexy movement. But my final question to you, when, not if, but when the European Union collapses, should we allow these buggers refuge in Africa?
Well, only if they come across on rubber dinghies and rickety boats. And then we'll hold them in Tunisia for a while and probably send them back to Europe.
Nice.
But a final question for you, Mandape. What the hell do you think we're going to talk about at this TEDx talk?
What the bloody hell is a TEDx talk?
Join the swashbuckling Zambezi news crew as they take their news show to Belgium to do a TEDx talk. Who is TED? Who is TED's ex? And what's a talk? Don't worry, Jerome and Mandape don't know either. They got offered a free flight to Europe. They're Africans, of course they took it. They've either come to Europe to go shopping, seek asylum, or both. One of them doesn't have a visa. Guess which one? You're so racist. Of course he has a visa. I've got a good mind to come over there and punch you in the face. I should have been doing movie trailers for Leonardo DiCaprio, not this shit. Good day, good night, I don't care, whatever.